morning to all of you.
Today,
we have a very, very distinguished panel member to discuss on the topic disruptive leadership. The people of various profiles, various backgrounds and various companies, all the five members are eminent personalities are here. And from the finance, from the HR, from the sourcing, and our moderator is the CEO of the company. I am very sure we will have an insightful session and you all will learn a lot.
Good morning to all dignitaries present on dais and my fellow student managers. I, Shreya Jain, student of Sri Balaji Society, welcome our vivacious personality, Mr. N. Balasubramanian. Mr. N. Balasubramanian is the CEO at Sresta Natural Bio Products Private Limited, the company behind India's leading organic brand, 24 Mantra Organic. Prior to joining Sresta, he worked with fruit and vegetable project with NDDB, that is National Dairy Development Bank, launched Tropicana in India. So, has been pioneer in setting pedigrees operation in India. He played a key strategic role to grow business driving results through collaboration, partnership and relationships. Thank you, sir, for being a part of this panel discussion.
Yes. I, Kavya Jain, feels privileged to introduce you to a very renowned personality, Mr. Amitabh Prasad. Sir is a well-rounded professional having 2.5 decades of industry experience in telecom and IT industry. Sir currently holds the position of Vice President and Head of Sourcing at Ericsson India. Sir is also on the sourcing board for Ericsson Global. Commercial operations, human resource management, uncompromising ethics and deep sense of what is right for the company are the core values he is bringing with him to the table. Thank you, sir, for being a part of this panel discussion.
I am Manpreet Singh, student of Shri Balaji Society, feel privileged to introduce you all to the corporate stalwart, Mr. Nayan Mehta. Mr. Nayan Mehta is the Chief Financial Officer of Bombay Stock Exchange Limited, BSE. He has extensive experience of over 24 years in the financial and securities market, especially in exchange and its ecosystem businesses. He is also a member of the Qualified Audit Review Committee of Securities and Exchange Board of India, SEBI. Thank you, sir, for being a part of this panel discussion.
I, Varsha Rajput, student manager of Balaji Institute of International Business, is feeling privileged to introduce to you all this charismatic personality, Mr. Apurv Choubey, sir. Sir is a senior HR professional with 25 years of diverse experience in organizational development and effectiveness, talent management and acquisitions, compensations and benefit, HR operations, employee relations, change management, leadership and development. He recently is holding the position of South Asia Head of HR for Syngenta and also serving as Global Director HR at Serum Institute. A thoughtful leader and an HR professional with an ability to impact organizations in the best positive way. His ability to think innovatively and out of the box has won him many laurels. Thank you, sir, for being a part of the panel discussion.
I, Rishabh Shukul, feel honored to give a brief introduction about a prominent personality, Mr. Bapuji. Sir is an ocean of knowledge. Sir did his executive courses from IIM Ahmedabad and XLRI Jamshedpur. Currently working with Jeeves, a Flipkart company, as a head HR. Prior to joining Flipkart, sir also worked with Escorts Limited, Monsanto India Limited, Honda Cars and Reliance Footprint Limited. Thank you, sir, for being a part of this panel discussion.
To start with, most of us, as you see here, are people who passed out of institutes maybe more than 25 years back. And it's really nice to see that the institute here is organizing workshops like this, which I think is a tremendous sort of source for you guys as youngsters to understand, pick up, not just read whatever stuff on the net, but also have people come from various sort of organizations and leadership positions come and talk about various subjects. So I really commend the institute on a program like this. And I'm sure this will help most of you to really, you know, face your after school life, after college life better. So I also must say that, you know, from the context of the topic, probably we're not the best panel. I think most of the disruption is being done by people in their 30s today, right? So, you know, some of us have done some good stuff in the past, probably continue to do some stuff, but all the big stuff which you read about, or dream about, are being done by lots of youngsters, right? I agree or no?
Yes, sir.
I always ask tricky questions, okay? It's a two-sided. So, which means this panel is not good enough, is what you're saying.
No, sir.
No, sir. Okay, fine. Good. Okay. So, what we will sort of be able to share is most of our understanding of the subject. We have seen a few things. We know a few things. But clearly, it's not all, right? Because time and again, especially in the last 10 odd years, a lot of youngsters have proven that there's much more to it than what we all bring to the table. Okay, so that's the big message from my side, that you guys, many of you can go beyond, do much more than what has been done today, right? But the big question here is, the subject says, the topic says, disruptive leadership. So how crucial, critical, is disruption for organizations today? Right? Is it something which is mandatory, which is required, or is it something which needs to be done only when you're in trouble? Right? Because most of the time, most of the organizations which grow to a certain size want to maintain status quo, want to do things the same way, almost day in and day out. They don't want to really make big changes, right? So how many of you think disruption is required? Yeah. So very few of you think disruption is required, looks like. Okay, so we'll see at the end of this discussion whether your minds, how, what changes you make, right? And what do you mean by a disruptive leader? Okay, so, you know, a disruptive leader is he or she somebody who disrupts things or who is very good at innovation, or is it something more than that? What do we mean by a disruptive leader? Okay. Because most of the time, most of the people in an organization get into a comfort zone fairly quickly. So the role of a disruptive leader is multifold. It's not just about an innovation, it's an idea, it's much more than that. To bring about a change in an organization, to bring about a change in the business model, to bring about the way an organization looks at the future, is the challenge. If that's a job, there's a role of a leader. But the big question in most of your minds should be, most of you will join any organization after you pass out as a manager or an executive or something like that. So what is the role you can play? Would this subject be of relevance to you in the next 2, 3, 4 years? Think about it. Right? Is it that we are talking about that big boss, the guy who's heading the company, senior guys, are those the people we are talking about? Yeah? Yeah? Are we going to talk only about the big guys, the senior guys in the company? Yeah? So the question is, you should be asking yourself, is it relevant for me? How do I make it relevant? Will it help me? Right? So if this panel is able to throw some light and give you some answers, that would be good. Because if you start applying, then maybe it will help you a lot. Okay? So I'll stop with that and probably request Apurv, you want to go?
Thank you. And just to kickstart this discussion, I think it's important for us to demystify this word called disruptive, you know, and the way that I look at it and others can contribute here is that we are looking at two things here. One, that we are looking at disruption, you know, which is beyond our control. Okay? So that could be, a disruption which is beyond the arena of our influence, which we cannot influence. You know? So that is a disruption that we are looking at. So that's one thing. The second thing that we are looking at here is disruptive leadership, which is more confined to organizations. And which is directly linked to innovation. And to put it simply, I think here in a layman's language, it is important for all of you to understand disruptive leadership is not a big a word. You don't have to get worried about it. You don't have to feel that what is this big thing called disruptive leadership. It's, to put it in a simple word, it is one's ability to challenge the status quo, okay? And as he said that we are all very comfortable in the way we've been operating for years together and we don't like any change because change is always uncomfortable, okay? So we continue to operate in the same way that we have been operating for years together. But if you continue to do that, so if you sit on a track, you get run over, you know, to put it simply. And as a result of that, I think it is important for leaders today to have ideas and challenge the status quo so that they can disrupt the way things have been going on in an organization so that they can look at new possibilities. They can look at new ways of progressing the organization in this VUCA world. And we can talk about VUCA world a little more later. But just to put things in context, this is what we mean by disruptive leadership, and today's focus for the discussion is going to be more around that. So we're not going to look at disruption as a whole, which happens in the world, you know. So somewhere there is some rule change and there is a disruption in the... Of course, we need to prepare the organization for those disruptions as well. But the focus today here is to look at that, how do we, have disruptive leaders impacting the organization and how the organizations need to prepare themselves for these disruptions. So, I thought I'd just clarify that.
Thanks. Nayan?
I'll just divert myself a bit from this concept of disruptive leadership, especially insofar as it concerns bosses. I actually lead a team of, say, around 30-odd guys. And many times, they come and tell me that, sir, this is the problem, sir, this is the problem, this is not happening. And when you actually go and seek some more information from them, why can't you do this? What is the other option available to you? Can you do this? Can you do that? And suddenly, then they sometimes feel that, okay, they have been made a fool of themselves. It was such a simple solution to that. Many times this simply happens that there is a problem, there is a need which has to be addressed. People many times, because of lack of common sense, which is very common, believe me, among you also, means when you report to people like me, I would see half of you, exhibiting that trait, believe me. But then it is very common, the thing which a boss expects from his subordinates, first thing is common sense. And solution. If you the thing is that most of the times problems are very easy to solve. It's just that you just go one more step. If you have played chess in life, five more steps you think and then you play chess. Here in actual life, if you consider two more steps, then okay, ye nahi hota hai, ab kya karenge? Ye nahi hota, ab kya karenge? Okay. And most of the time we'll come out with a very reasonable, very practical solutions. I think this is disruption, Disruption is a point where you identify a problem, where you identify a need, and you go seek a solution to it, and you create a disruption wherever you are. You can be at the lowest end of the pyramid. You can be at the topmost end of the topmost at the highest position. So obviously means as we discuss further, obviously you know, I don't want to just take away bites from my colleagues. So I'll leave it to this now.
As Nayan said, and before that Apurva said, disruption is does not come in any special shape and form, and you would not see a situation and well, you will say, well, this is right for disruption. Disruption is all about us, is all around us, and it's happening all the time. A small step, what in let's say past of industrialization we used to say value engineering, has become innovation over a period of time, and is now to me that is where the heart of disruption lies, in innovation. Disruptions are not when Steve Jobs puts up an iPhone or an iPod, or when Henry Ford did a T model, or Apple fell on the ground and going upwards to Newton. This disruption is when you make that change happen, and that change is relevant to people, and that change is relevant to the organization, and that change you have brought about by displaying a behavior, a leadership which is up above the other people, is up above what has been, as Apurva said, a steady state, and is perhaps dare to be different. And today we are driven to disruption or disruptive or being innovative. I come from telecom and IT, and you would not have seen perhaps a larger disruption in telecom as you are seeing in last 18 months. And the result is in front of us. So there is a small step, there is a large step, and then there are very large steps. It is with us, it is with our neighbors, and it is with society in general. And it is inside the organization. So what is important for us as a leaders is when we see those offshoots of innovation, offshoots of, I would say, disruption, we just don't water it down as just another idea, but have the conviction and feeling that, yes, this is what we need to run. This is, we create an environment where our team, what Nayan was saying, that our team is fearless in trying out new ideas. And perhaps, Bapuji, you will pick up on this on a very, very new age organization where the bosses are 18, 22 or 25 year old. And then when they come to you with a new idea, you feel telling them that, well, your age is equal to the amount of years I have put in the industry. So how about that? So perhaps you will be able to build on this, Bapuji, what I'm trying to say. But do not imagine disruption as something which is large and hairy and audacious and whatnot you would have read in your management books, but something which is all pervasive, happens on a daily basis, every moment. We are all part of it. It's about us in our private lives, and it's about us as leaders in our professional life, how to tap into that and make it relevant to the people. When I say people, who is the person who is most important in a business? Can you try? Who is the person who is most important in a business? Is it the CEO or your boss or somebody else? Sorry? Wow. You have done a fabulous job of putting customer first. Absolutely. If you have not made difference to the life of a person on the street who is using your product or service, I mean, we can all be happy about it, but it has not achieved the result. So, wonderful. I think it's a very, very fertile mind here. So, why don't you?
Yeah. Please, so, he's the one, you know, can throw a lot more light on, Amitabh said, you know, how the younger lord is from Flipkart, as you heard. So, he probably has lots to share.
So, good morning to all of you.
Good morning, sir.
So, I'll just try to brief some more points further to my senior panelists, what they have put into the context. So, disruption has been a buzzword for last 5 to 8 years, and it has evolved over a period of time. So it started from minor incremental changes, daily changes, few improvements, and going forward, it has taken a shape where, with the help of innovation, a complete, a different normal, new normal, we call it as new norm. So this has come about with a sudden change in the way we are doing things. To elaborate it further in the discussion further, I'll try to give you more and more instances, experiences and examples, some of the examples at a global level, some of them at national level, some of them at local level, some of them from Pune, and some of them from BITM. So we'll try to link and understand how disruption is changing the way society is living, how disruption is changing the way of our social structures. It is not just affecting an individual. A small incremental new patent or a new invention is not good enough for disruption today. It is just that Maruti came up with a better car and maybe sales of ambassador cars has gone down. That is not good enough a disruption in today's situation. It completely changes the paradigm of the way people use goods and services. So one of the most common and easy to understand disruptive tool, service or an application is WhatsApp. So all of you agree with this?
Yes, sir.
So what WhatsApp has changed? Yeah, to some extent, but it is actually stealing away a lot of productive hours from daily life. It's different way of looking at disruption. It is a good tool to do a lot of things, you said, lot of things that it does better, but it also does few things which will not add productively to our day-to-day lives. Agree with me?
Yes, sir.
Okay, good. And how did you learn WhatsApp? Somebody taught you?
No, sir.
Somebody gifted? Did you purchase it?
No, sir.
So that is one good example of disruption. So as we go forward, we will try to say more about different examples. And disruption has reached in our generation a stage where every single day we see something new coming up, and it completely changes the ecosystem. It completely changes the way we use them, which we would have never thought before. Right? So some more examples my senior colleagues will be explaining, and with this I'll move on to Mr. Bala.
Thank you, Bapuji. So yeah, I mean, WhatsApp is definitely one thing that's caused disruption. But I think from the point of view of our young friends here, what will be important and useful to understand from the panel is, you know, do organizations really need disruption? And if you look at historically, so many companies which were doing very well are not doing so well today. Companies which have started a few years back. So what we, most of you see are maybe 10% of the organizations which did disruption, which created something and are successful. Majority of the organizations, say 90% of them, do not succeed as well. Okay, so we have to get the context right. Is it disruption for the sake of disruption? What exactly are we talking about here? And therefore, what is the role of this leader who is supposed to lead this disruption? So, in our books, from professors, from many of us, and from all sources, you will hear about companies with missed opportunities. Whether it was, it's from Xerox. Apparently, when the first time the gentleman went to IBM and presented his idea, IBM just asked him to get out of the reception. And this man went back and, am I correct?
And also, Steve Jobs said that if Xerox were able to implement all the ideas they had, there was no need for an IBM, Apple or,
yeah,
or Microsoft today.
Correct.
So they had so much of idea, but
yeah,
it was only, it takes a Steve Jobs to bring that into your hands.
Yeah. So sometimes the our enthusiasm and our excitement kind of makes us believe that lots of things we can do, right? But when you look at a leader, when you look at how he or she is supposed to create this disruption and yet manage an organization which is working, which is running. So there's a famous saying in management, if it is working, why do you want to fix it? It's working, let it work, right? And so there are examples of organizations which have, collapsed, not done well, because they didn't fix it, because they didn't change course. They didn't take to new technology. I think one of the examples is Kodak. There are many examples like that, which didn't adapt to changes, right? But there are many we don't know about who started off and are not there today. So what exactly is the DNA? What is required to create and manage disruption? And what leader are we talking about, right? So at one level I said, many of you should not be thinking that it's only a leader's job, big boss's job. It's also up to you guys to make the changes, make little changes, big changes in your way of working. But also there is a leader of the organization who sets the tone, who empowers the organization, who makes sure that, people in the organization feel that they can do disruption, they can do things differently. So, it'll be interesting to hear from the panel, what are we talking about?
I think one more thing that we need to understand very clearly is, we talked about need for disruption. I think if I look at it in a larger context, the need for disruption emanates from the consumers. And that is one. The second one is that need for survival. Okay, there is so much of fierce competition in the market, and people are struggling to survive because the consumer needs are changing very fast. They're changing with the preference is changing with the consumers, and hence disruption is very, very important. What sold 10 years back, it's no more relevant today. And hence, the organizations need to adopt disruptive ways of coming up with new products, new services, innovative products, innovative services, so that they can not only survive and also service their customers. So those are the things. And I can give you one example from my previous organization. We were a product-centric organization, and we were selling a product to the customer. And we realized that there is a need to provide services to the customer. So we said our focus need to change from being a product organization to a service organization or a solution organization. So we combined two businesses of ours. We said, okay, let's combine these two businesses and then go to the customer and give him the entire solution for a particular problem, right? And not only the product, wherein the other organizations were still selling products. So what we did, it was absolutely a disruptive idea, wherein we said we had never done it before. And the entire competition said that this is suicidal for you guys. It's not going to work. And we said we still want to try it. So we went ahead and we did that. That meant that, we had to prepare the organization for this change. So change is the most important thing, any disruption. If you don't prepare the organization and you go in for a disruption, or a change like this, you're going to fall flat on your face. Okay, so remember, change is the most important thing. You have to be change ready. And we can talk more about that. So we went to the customer with the solution, and customer liked that because no other competition was providing that kind of solution. They were only selling products. So we said, okay, this is where you are from beginning to end. This is how we'll serve you. And it worked for us. But to do that, there were a lot of changes that the organization had to make internally. And those changes were basically one that, you know, if you are having any disruptive idea and you want to implement that, most important thing for any organization is to bring people on board with that idea. Because unless people within your organization understand the purpose of what is being done, you know, you're not going to succeed. But they are the ones who are going to make it happen for you. Okay? So the change preparedness, the change purpose has to be communicated. There has to be very clear understanding with people that how this change will be carried out. You know, how people will be trained, because the skill sets will change with that. So these are some of the repercussions of disruptive ways of working. But they are very, very important in today's context. I don't know how many of you have read the book by Marshall Goldsmith, What Got You Here Will Take You There, right? There is no guarantee. So what has worked for you so far, there is no guarantee that it's going to work for you in the future as well. So hence, disruption is a way of life, and one has to adopt that, and one has to figure out that in this disruptive world, how do you survive? What are the skills that you develop, you know, so that they're useful for you? How do you work in an organization? Because every individual has a role to play in this disruptive world. And this is not going to go away. What you have to learn and understand is that how fast you can get through that change curve from denial to acceptance. If you can do it quickly, you'll be very successful. If you can't do it, you'll be left behind. That's what happens with organizations as well, and that is what will happen with individuals as well. So change is the key word here, please remember.
So that's absolutely, I think that's a critical point, that, you know, the change is a constant, so we need to keep changing to adopt. But I think so what I'm also picking up is really leader who needs to bring or wants to bring disruption or change probably has to have a clear vision in mind, his own mind, her own mind, set it out, and basically get the organization or the team members aligned, enthused about the vision, about his or her expectation, right? That's critical, because whether it's for changes to improve the current way of working or completely changed the entire paradigm of working, he or she needs to align. And I think one critical point on which I would again request panelists to throw light on is most of disruption or change happens, and if you read about whether the Flipkart founders or the Travis Kalanick of Uber or many of people who have started something absolutely new, which we all look up upon, I think they had a certain need, they had a certain hunger, they had a certain desire, right? I think it's critical to remember that change will happen, disruption will happen, progress will happen, dependent on how hungry or desirous you are of that, of anyone, whether it's the leader of the organization or team members in that organization. I think part of the role for a leader is to build that hunger in the team and the desire in the team. Yeah, Bapuji, you want to go? Yeah.
Example of WhatsApp. So some of you are trying to check it. So some of your heads are down. Just to create some disruption, I'll take a little bit deviation from the discussion. So Mr. Apurv gave an idea of why disruption and why change. So partially I agree with him, and partially I also disagree with him, so that you guys come back. One is, change is, as the old saying goes, necessity is mother of invention. All we learned, all we feel that. So change, constant change is not driven by organizations or governments. It is given by end consumer. End user says, I am not going to buy any more Bajaj scooter. I want a funky, high mileage Honda bike. So customer is telling, please stop this product, give me a different product. So I have to change. So change is constant, driven by customer. Whereas disruption is driven by the innovator. None of us went to Kalashnikov and asked him to give us WhatsApp. None of us went to Uber and told them, give us a better taxi facility. So it is driven by organizations to begin, or organizations to exist, or to change the way we do our daily lives. Or, to put it in more simpler words, I'll try to borrow some words from Mr. Sundar Pichaya, who is been very successful manager. To some extent, he was also a very disruptive manager. And he says, disruption will come when you identify a problem. And then, how do you figure out a solution that will completely change the way you solve that problem? So I had a problem of communication, so that was solved by WhatsApp. I had a problem of daily office commuting, that is solved by Uber. All of you are aware of Uber?
Yes, sir.
Very good, very good. Maybe when we were students, we were not acquainted with taxis actually. Mostly we were going by walking or sometimes public transport. So Uber is the largest taxi operator, and how many cars it owns? Very good. So today it has captured close to 27% of taxi segment globally and doesn't own any taxi. Right? Similarly, you must be knowing about media houses, news, TV channels. So there will be a team which will be working behind to produce content. Who will be good in language, who will be good in communication. So they prepare a lot of things which will be eventually broadcasted. So they are called as content writers. Some of them will be intellectuals, and nowadays little doubtful, but they are the people who generate the content. So today, which is the biggest publishing house? Any guesses? Yeah, very right. So Facebook is the largest publisher today. And who are the content, how many content writers they have? Very right. So Facebook, being the largest content producer, doesn't have any content writer. Clear? So that is the way how disruption is changing. And disruption is led by organizations, not by customers. Change is pushed by customers, but disruption is coming from thin air, from nowhere. Right? So going forward, we will give you some more local Pune-centric examples. Serum Institute is one good example, which completely disrupted the product market in vaccines.
So bringing this up, and I can give you one example of Serum itself. You know, it's absolutely disruptive, the way it happens. So we are one of the largest vaccine producers in the world. In terms of dosages, we produce 1.6 billion dosages of different kinds of vaccines. You know, so we do that. We are also the largest suppliers of vaccines to WHO and UNICEF, okay? Now, typically, if you look at it, what is your idea of a vaccine? How do you take it? You go to a doctor, they have a vial of vaccine and you get injected with that, right? Whether it was H1N1, MMR or any vaccine you take, for example. Now, there is a disruptive technology which is going to be a very, very shocking technology for the competition. The technology that Serum has worked on and is going to be out in the market in next 2 years' time is a patch. So you want to take a vaccine, you go to a doctor, or you can buy it from, you don't even have to go to a doctor. See the innovation here. You don't have to go to a doctor, you go to a medical store with a prescription and you say, give me one patch of H1N1. You take that patch, rip it like a sticker, you put it on your wrist and you press it for 2 minutes and your vaccination is done. You remove it and throw it. You're done with it. Right? So that's a disruptive technology. And that's innovation, what he was talking about. Right? So that's what Serum is doing. So I thought just I'd share this example. It's a very relevant example. And many of the competition will be really surprised with this kind of innovations and take years for them to catch up with this.
So right? Just to differentiate between innovation and disruption. I mean, I'm probably, I think the topic in sense of leadership leading to disruption, probably.
Yeah, so just building on this wonderful innovation and disruption. Let's say this patch is now available. You are not putting that syringe inside your body. What do you visualize? How many jobs will be lost in the process? Who all will lose their job? So a lot of paramedics will lose their jobs, right? Now tell me, is it right or is it not so right? I heard somebody saying right. Not so right. All right. What do those people are supposed to do? What would they do? Sorry? That's where this disruption is so important for leaders to visualize and put into a corporate practice. If I know for sure the change is inevitable, the disruptions will happen. It will. The disruptions are aimed at making the life easier for people in general. And if this is the way it will happen, maybe 2 years, 5 years, or 10 years down the road, and if we are not preparing, if we are not visionary enough to prepare for such eventualities, we will suddenly see a lot of jobs evaporating and social unrest and the pressures it has of unemployment and so on and so forth. And those people now have to really visualize that where do they now fit in the value chain? Where do they move up? Are they moving up and trying from paramedics to medic or somewhere else or somewhere else, somewhere else? There is a place for everyone. There is need for everyone. And if it is not well cited, well understood and acted upon in early days, then there is a challenge. I'll give you one very example of mobile tower sites. Have you seen mobile tower sites? Do you remember what is a tower site? Is what is the shape and form of a tower site? I see. This very nice. And I'll just help you out here. So what used to be a 70-meter tower in the ages when you were perhaps in your last 7, 8, or 9, or 10 is just one standing pole on top of a building. Today. Imagine the amount of jobs which have vanished. Imagine the amount of jobs which are redundant. Imagine the simplicity. Imagine the use and the ease to the end user, to the operator, and to the whole value chain. Those people, the jobs which were vanished, they are also have moved in the value chain. And that is where the organizations have to prepare. If they don't see the train, then perhaps it will hit. They realize where the train is coming from the other side of the tunnel. And all of us as a leaders and all of us in the room, at no matter where they are, in which part of organization, which part of the pyramid, as Nayan was alluding to, have a job to see that what is going to happen to us and how do we find a better way for all of us as we move up the value chain. That's the role I would briefly say is a leader, or all of us have to be very, very perceptive and proactive about it. Otherwise, we'll be just steamrolled.
Yeah, so I think one of the takeaways from this is that any disruption or any innovation will always have unknown repercussions. Okay, so the repercussion here that what we talked about is unemployment. A lot of people lose their jobs. And how do we fit them in the whole scheme of things and how they move up the value chain. So this will happen, this will continue to happen. Okay, and we'll have to continue to find the ways and means of engaging people and making sure that people don't lose their jobs, and hence creating those skills so that they remain employable and we build employability for those people going forward. Whichever sector it is in, whatever we do, any disruption will have those ramifications, will have those unknown impacts within the society. So we need collateral damage. We need to be cognizant of it.
You know, the question which was raised by Mr. Bala was this: do organizations need disruption? I will not say it is question of need. Basically, disruption is as Mr. Bapuji said, that this disruption comes from more of a entrepreneurial spirit from promoters. They seek out some new ways to do things. And change is driven by the consumer. Now let's take it this way. Suppose you are the MD or you are in some senior management position. You will be in a few years' time, definitely. Just go back, just rewind 20 or 30 years from now, 40 years from now. You are in some company called as Blockbuster. Blockbuster was basically into hiring of DVDs, VHS films. So you remember putting a big cassette into VHS and seeing movies. Yeah, they won't know. Okay. Now, just like you have CDs now, you had something called as VHS earlier. So the point is this, that it was a big business, that anybody who wants to see movie at home, they will hire those cassettes and they will put the cassette in the player and they will see the movie at home. There will be a rent for it. The best part about this for the company was this, that the company used to get a lot more money from penalties rather than from rentals. So what would generally happen, just as you take some book from library and most of the time you end up delaying it, giving it back to the library. Same thing, people used to take cassettes on rent and again they will delay and they will pay penalty charges to Blockbuster, which was actually hiring, giving it on rent to this all the customers. So one fine day, one of you guys actually went there and you paid up a $40 fine for giving your cassette late. And then you started thinking, boss, how is it happening to me? Means, I would have paid rent of $5 and I'm paying delay of $40. So something is desperately wrong in my life. How can I do something so that, we don't have to pay rent? So he started a company, one of you. It was simply one person, just one of you, who just thought about it. There is a problem. You identify the problem. Now, let's figure out what can be the solution for that. So he decides that, okay, let us do a mail order type of, a mail order type of business where anybody can take CD on, if somebody wants a CD on net, I will send it by courier, that is the United States Postal Service, and he can send it back to me. Then, you went on thinking. You just think you are one of them. You are one of the guys who was actually thinking all this. A few friends, business started slowly. Nobody really objected. Nobody really fought with you. Then, one thing which came across your mind, you are still a very innovative, creative type of guy or a girl. And you then think that, you know, these guys are actually paying $5 for my rent and another $5 for the courier. So actually, effectively, he is actually paying little more than what he should be paying as rent to me. So then you say, let's see if there is some new technology which has come, which is called as a streaming technology. Where can we give it, you know, streaming to those guys? So then you say that, okay, then you offer your customers that you don't even need to take cassettes on rent. I don't need to send it to you hard, you know, hard copy of it. You simply see it on your desk at your place. Use your internet. Then again, the issue came that, you know, means how to have a steady stream of income for it. So then he decided that, okay, let's charge a monthly annual subscription. Let the person see as many movies he wants in a given month, and I'll charge on a subscription basis. Now, this is what you are doing, and I'm in Blockbuster. I'm just watching you. Okay, he's doing this. Okay, he's doing this. Okay, he's doing this. What am I doing? I'm just puffing at your idea. No, no, he's a stupid kid. He doesn't know. Huh? But that kid, finally, that person who comes up with those ideas, he takes it to a level where he becomes a threat to me. So, to such an extent that my business starts going down because people don't want to come and buy cassettes from me, take on rent cassettes from me. They want to do it directly at home by streaming. Now, when my business starts getting affected, so what I do is that, you know, I take some baby steps. I go and then, you know, I go and tell my customers, boss, I'm not going to charge you penalty. You just take the cassettes and you give it back to me. No penalties. Whenever you give it back, it's okay with me. The problem is, the customer has got the movie at his home now. He doesn't need to come to your shop at all. Why are you now giving an idea? Why are you giving a solution which is totally irrelevant to him? And that is lack of common sense on my part. That I am not able to identify what is the requirement of my customer, and I am offering him something which is totally meaningless for him. So, at the end of it, to cut the story short, ultimately, Blockbuster had to wind up, and the person, one of you, who started this business is Netflix now.
So, just before Bapuji wants to chip in, I know, the one disruption which youngsters like you have caused a huge headache for Netflix today. You know what is that? What is it?
No.
What is causing headaches to Netflix in India today? Okay? Netflix offers 4 connections. Okay? All of you know that, right? Because in the US, you have 2 televisions or laptops and mobile, everything, right? But whatever Indians done smartly, 4 people share, right? So Netflix revenue model is under huge stress today in India, okay? So that's our disruption over Netflix. Somebody was brilliant, so we are a little more brilliant, okay? So, small example, okay?
Now, you have heard some good examples, and you also got definitions, meaning of disruption. So I'll try to put disruption in one sentence, rather what disruption does. Essentially, disruption does 3 things, right? It makes life better, it makes life or cost of service cheaper, and it makes all those things faster. Better, cheaper, faster. So that is what disruption essentially does. Sometimes, if it is negative disruption, probably it may not make life better. One bad example could be invention of ISIS. Right? But it does faster. Right? It holds other 2 parameters, better, cheaper, faster. It does destruction faster, it does destruction cheaper as well. But all other inventions, like we said, Uber. One more example I would like to give is Airbnb. Yeah. So what is Airbnb? Largest accommodation arrangement company, which today captures about 18% of the high-end segment accommodation. How many hotels it has got? Very good. So next example would be Nayan. So when I started my career, I have a problem. Problem is, I neither belong to this side, so nor belong to this side. In the 14 years of experience, so I got lot of things to learn from my seniors, like all of them. Then a big challenge of unlearning all those things, make it blank, and then relearn from all the youngsters. When I started my career, my immediate superior or boss was having an experience more than my age. Today my boss is 15 to 18 years younger than me, and his boss is 3 years younger to him. But both of them are extremely competent, and I do respect them as the bosses I used to respect my earlier times, and they're really good. They're able to try and teach and make me learn as much as my earlier legendary bosses did. So that is a big disruption. And coming back to the example of disruption, so when I started my career early, so when I wanted to buy a share, it used to be a Herculean task. You understand share and share market?
Yes, sir.
Then BSE did biggest disruption.
Otherwise, queue up.
So maybe if Nayan can elaborate little more. Today, if I want to buy a share, I can just buy on click of my mobile. Everything is done. Transaction, it comes to my account. Everything is done. To me, that is one of the biggest disruptions sitting next to me. Maybe Nayan, if you can explain a little bit more.
But that's great. And I must tell you a funny anecdote. I think this, because most of these guys are getting a little bored. This no sir is not loud enough to convince me. So I was on a flight, and as I said, I'm man of extreme. So I saw at that time RBI Governor Mr. Y.V. Reddy board the flight in Hyderabad, and like a ordinary passenger, right? He just walked in the queue, sat in his particular seat, economy class, not in business class. So I walked up to him, I wished him, and I said, "Sir, this is amazing that your RBI Governor probably signed checks for crores or lakhs and whatever. And here you are in a queue and sitting, you know, with everyone else without being noticed." And I said, complimented him publicly, loved me. I have a loud voice. And all of that happened. I went back to my seat and sat. And after 2 minutes, I observed that the passenger sitting next to him was asking him, "Sir, can you give me tips on my share?" So he said, no, sir, I don't deal in shares. So that's a funny part. But I think one important thing which we've not touched upon, which is about what are the leadership traits, right? We talked about people who create disruption, okay? So leader needs to have the vision. Leader needs to have absolute conviction in what he or she is recommending or trying to do. Leader needs to be able to take the team along. This is what we talked about, okay? But equally important factor is a leader needs to be relentless, okay? You have endless stories. I used to work for PepsiCo. I've heard stories about a person who launched Pepsi, went bankrupt, then again pursued. Today, it's about Jeff Bezos of Amazon, and many people who have suffered, struggled, but never gave up their ideas, never gave up their dreams. Okay, they kept pursuing, they were relentless in what they wanted to do at the end of the day. And that's a critical trait, right? And I'm not talking about, as I said earlier in my opening remarks, it's not only about the big boys, big leaders, big people. Many of you step into an organization from the institute now. How do you pursue this thought of being a little disruptive, a little different? Will everyone just open up their arms and allow you to do what you want? May not happen. Okay? Most probably will not happen. Even in young organizations, may not happen. Right? I have a friend who is pretty senior in, let's say, Google in the US. He does this whole business of data analytics for Google globally. He's a boss. He's got people reporting to him from all over the world, from Australia to whatever. So practically doesn't sleep, as he says, because Australia wakes up at one time and then the whole world, right? But he says the Google structure is such that everybody is encouraged to be an entrepreneur. There are no boundaries. And he says, believe me, it's the biggest nightmare we have, because you're not supposed to put down anybody who's a sort of come up with a good idea and so on and so forth, right? And that's person my age speaking. So that you will find even in a Google where it is encouraged on paper. But in reality, in organizations, you will find not all doors opening. So the key is, even if at whatever level you join and you are in an organization, you want to make a difference, you want to disrupt, you want to make changes as a leader. Every one of you will end up as a leader of a small team, big team, whatever, right? So how do you make that change? Right? All the traits, but very critical, being relentless. Being relentless in your pursuit. Okay? Now I get everybody's attention. That's great. So if other panelists have something else to contribute, please do. Otherwise, I would like to throw it open so that there are questions and you can get more specific answers to your questions. And therefore, it's a little more interesting than just all of us talking. If that's okay with others. Yeah, okay.
I'll just build a small point and then perhaps we do that. So when Bala says relentless, it's about the passion. Yeah, the passion which you drive. Nobody tells you to be passionate. It comes from within. It comes from your conviction that yes, it's a wonderful idea. It's going to be very, 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 very different and helpful to people. So you show passion. At the same time, the stat says that not more than a very small percentage of good ideas actually take shape. So there is a fear of failure. And that fear, as in an organization or to that matter institutions like this, they have to develop a sense that failure is fine, as much as it is not repeated perhaps. But fear of failure and appreciation for failure is very, very important. And that is where one needs to be dispassionate as well. If it has a failed idea, drop it, move on. Drop it, move on, till the time you hit the right idea. So I just thought that is important, especially in the institution. If your CGPA is down, I don't know how easy your prof would be with you. Yeah. Not many of them are here. But if you have spent that much time in developing an idea in the lab, but your CGPA went down, is there some sort of shock absorber in the system or not? I would not be aware of. But all of us as a society have to support the failure and what it means to people who tried those ideas.
Okay, thanks. Thanks, Amitabh. So, how many of you want to be entrepreneurs when you step out, not work somewhere? Look at that, look at that, look at that. Wow, wow, wow. Yeah? So, I'm sure many of you have... Hello, the clapping got over 2 minutes back, my friend. 4 minutes over here. Thoda. Okay? So, please... feel free, all those who put up their hands, you might have a certain set of questions. All those who didn't might have a slightly different set of questions. Oh, what about this company? What do I do? Right? What is the description for me? Or the entrepreneurial guys might have a separate set of questions. Please feel free. I'm sure most of your questions we'll try to answer as best as we can. Okay? Please go ahead. Help yourself. Come on, guys. Okay.
So, before we start, I'll just add one more sentence with your permission. When I grew up, always I was told, don't create any disruption. Just follow the law, study properly, get good marks, become a good officer or a manager. So it was a detailed coaching from house to office to college to mentor all my bosses. Don't do any disruption. Thank you. But now it is a situation where we are actually encouraging you to create some disruption and most probably create a positive disruption. Yeah? Yeah. Let us take questions.
Very good afternoon, sir. I'm Alpha Kamal, and sir, we are very privileged to have all of you here. So my question is to Nayan, sir. Sir, how has disruption led to research and development section? And how is Serum dealing with this disruption? And how will it lead to losing of jobs in R&D section? Thank you.
Okay, so I think there are no job losses as far as the company is concerned, because R&D has a lot of work, and this is the outcome of a lot of effort that has been put in by the R&D guys, you know. So in fact, they like to work on innovations, and we have whole lot of doctors working on these kind of things. So a lot of innovation happens there. Now, the success of the innovation is only when it hits the market and it reaches the consumer, and then only we will come to know whether it is successful or it is not successful. But it's always about trial and error. You know? So we keep trying new things, we keep experimenting it within the organization. If we succeed, and I don't know how much you know about this industry, but there are a whole lot of stage gates, and there are a whole lot of
done training in your company.
Trials which happen. So, you know, the gestation period is very, very long. So that's how it works.
But by the way, most of the new innovations and disruptions bring about new jobs. So it's very rare that you have job losses. Like sum total is never a job loss. Okay.
Yeah, it is more of rearranging.
Yeah.
For example, I can tell you that if one example that I talked about, the patches, you know, once we in a small way try it out in the market, you know, it will create more jobs with the competition. Because they would like to try out something new. They would like to try out what Serum is doing. So they employ more people, you know. They spend more on R&D. So it creates more job opportunities for people, right?
Being the, my question is, being the market leader till 2007, why Nokia didn't come with disruptive idea like the way Motorola came and now regaining the market? Collaboration with Microsoft also didn't serve their purpose.
Nokia thought they know what they sell is what people would buy. They were very happy to understand that they thought they had the pulse with almost 70%+ market share of mobile handsets. And when the Android came in and completely put, when the hardware became irrelevant, so it is either Android or iOS, in that space, have you ever heard of a name called Symbian?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Symbian also was an OS. Does it exist now?
No.
So Nokia said, well, I also have Symbian and I'll fight with all of you. But my Symbian will only run on my hardware. And when iOS and Android, they made every hardware look very similar to what they did. And there was, that was one. Two is, they, all these two providers, Android and iOS, had a huge band of individuals, entrepreneurs, aspiring people like you, who would develop apps for them. You know, the apps would be developed by anybody, and once the app is uploaded on the platform, it has done some quality parameters. If so, then within 7 days, the app is available on either Play Store or iOS. And the apps is actually representing what the user wants and what is that set of people, what they want to do with their mobile phones. So app for you may not be important for me and the other way around. And once that started building up, the whole ecosystem becomes so strong and Nokia totally lost out. Today, if you see, they are launching a smartphone with Android as an OS. And that is what the market forces has turned them into today. Yeah.
So the larger point is, what went in technically and what everybody understands that. But I think the lesson from that is really, is the leader really in touch with the market? Is he or she seeing the changes happen? Okay, that's the role of the leader. And sometimes it doesn't happen because sometimes you are so caught up with your own success that you tend to sort of ignore changes which are happening, right? You believe a lot in yourself, but fail to notice the changes which are happening, right? And it happens. It happens to the best of companies. There are plenty of examples of that, apart from Nokia, many more.
I think just to add, this also can be termed as, and many of you who are doing marketing would know that better, it's also called marketing myopia. The organizations have failed to understand what's going to hit them in the future and how the consumer behavior will change. They, as he said, they become complacent.
So what used to happen, and he's saying, I will not share, but I'm an extreme guy. I had people who used to work for me, they went and worked for Nokia. The big boss used to say, work harder. So this man would work 14 hours a day, then 2 months later, 16 hours a day, trying to sell more, but sales were crashing. And in spite of all the signals going up, I think the guys in the business didn't take notice, right? So that is an issue. So that's why one has to, like I said, a leader has to play that role of recognizing the change when it's happening. Yeah, thanks.
And just to add, BlackBerry also didn't learn from it.
Yeah, correct. Yeah, please go ahead.
Good afternoon, all the panel members. I have a question. What disruptive brand do you think will be the next one to completely implode and disappear without hardly a trace in the market?
Completely implode?
Yes.
What would come next is the question.
No. What will completely collapse?
What will completely collapse with some of my understandings in recent articles? Probably we may not see any more laptops and desktops in next 5 to 8 years.
But she's asking anything which is disruptive today which will collapse.
A lot of them. Have you heard of something called Orkut?
Yes.
Is it existing today? Okay. So it is quite likely an extremely well-doing Uber might not exist maybe 8 to 10 years down the line. Just because there will be an individualistic Uber model where each one of us will have contacts of a driver wherein I can call him the way I want, the time I want. Today I want a bigger car, I can call him. Maybe tomorrow I want a smaller car, I can call. That will be my own Bapuji app. So that means, which is doing extremely well today, is perceived to be extinct in next 5 to 8 years. Was that the question?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Uber is one good example.
So, there are, so obviously, it's difficult to name today, because if we know, I'm sure the company which is running that business will also know that it's going to implode, right? So, difficult answer, but we'll watch the space, okay? My team here is saying, boss, you sit on the stage and say nice things, never implement them. So let me give him a chance to ask. Ashutha, is our HR head?
I stand here because it's not a question, it's a point. I was actually kind of pondering over when the learned panel members were discussing about this issue. So Bapuji asked a question that, what has changed in our life? So I was thinking what actually it has changed. In fact, it has changed my sitting pattern, I used to sit like this earlier, now I sit like this. Always looking at WhatsApp. And that has generated some amount of spontaneities also. So I believe that is a change, lifestyle change it has generated. Now my question is, when I think about this term called disruptive leadership, I believe this term has been coined by some consultant, you know, because fancy term, and consultants make good money out of that. So it's actually, you know, kind of, it's not a big idea. I believe all of them has tried to touch upon that, you know, disruptive term itself per se is not a very big thing. Tell me one you know, kind of thing, you know, one example. Suppose you purchase a new shirt, okay, and you wear that, go out for a party, and suddenly you realize in the party that something is poking inside the shirt, right? So what do? You try to go to the, you know, change room as quickly as possible, or you come back to your home, open the shirt, and try to find out that what is poking, right? Something is poking inside, new shirt, but uncomfortable. And you try to, you know, pull that out. Maybe some small pin or some stapler, something is there, some staple is there. Take that out. Right? So, you take that out and feel comfortable that, okay, the pain point is not there. That is what. That is what. That's just taking out the point of uncomfortable feeling, right? In our workplace also the similar kind of thing happens. You go to work, every day there is some uncomfortable thing happening, which is not very nice. But what happens as human being, our eyes and ears and all our five senses become habituated to certain things. We are not able to find out that what is uncomfortable happening. If I'm able to pick that uncomfortable thing up, I can pull that out, right? That's a small change. I'm not talking about huge changes. I'm not talking about innovation. I'm not talking about lifestyle changes. I'm talking about small, small changes. Can happen? So only thing is needed is the five senses to be alert to find out that what is that change needed. That reminds me of a saying by Aditya Birla, the founder of Aditya Birla Group. He said in Hindi that choti-choti baaton se purnata aati hai. Choti-choti baaton se purnata aati hai aur purnata koi choti baat nahi hai. So what does that mean? Small, small things can make a big impact. And big impact is not a small thing, right? He also said that sab kuch chalta hai, nahi chalega. That's an attitude normally we have, right? Theek hai, chalne do, chalta hai. Theek hai, chalega, chalne do. Sab kuch chalta hai, nahi chalega. If that attitude comes into place, then you tend to disrupt. Then you change the situations around you, right? And the moment you try to change the situation around you, you are a disruptive leader. Isn't it so? So you are a disruptive leader. Baba was asking about traits of disruptive leaders. I would say the first trait of disruptive leader is to identify the problems, the ability to identify a problem, or the ability to, you know, kind of appreciate that there is a problem. Most of the times we don't appreciate that there is a problem, right? Sab kuch chalta hai, theek hai, chalega. So that is something, that's a kind of, you know, feeling which is coming to my mind, that if you ask from a layman's perspective, I am a layman, I am not learned. But from a layman's perspective, I believe disruption is nothing but changing small, small things around me which are bothering me. Until that time, I am able to find it out, I am able to identify it, I am a disruptive leader. Thank you so much.
So my question is to Nayan Mehta, sir. Sir, in case of IPO, in this year alone, around 100 plus companies have been entered in the market. So what is the reason behind it, sir? Is this because of economic growth or market movement or to keep up the buyback and IPO share ratio? So what is the reason, sir?
Okay, now just take an example. Means about 40-50% of you raised hands when Balasar asked how many of you want to start your own business. Now tell me one thing, you start your own business, you have some capital in hand, you want to grow further, you need more capital. When will you come to market for raising funds? When the market is down or the market is up? So whenever the market is up, there is demand for your security, for your shares, and you as promoter realize that this is the best time to hit the market because you can get much better valuations and your economic value goes up. You unlock the value for your shareholders also and for yourself also. You get much higher money than otherwise you would have got. That's why whenever there is markets go up, the demand for securities go up, most of the time promoters tend to come and raise funds at that point of time.
Sir, in that case, good companies like AB Capital and SBI Life Insurance, what happened to those companies, sir? It has been down.
So that's little, I think, you can ask offline. Okay, that is not, I think.
Anyway, I'll just hazard a guess on this point. See, I'll tell you what. Suppose, you know, just take a simple example that you have raised a company, you have started a company, and you say that, you know, I have been working in this company for last 5 years, you know, I have built it up to this level. Now for every share of 10 rupees, I want 100 rupees because I have raised it to this level and they are coming at this point of time. Now I am an investor. I might think that, you know, yes, you have done a very good job, but I should not, that 100 rupees you are asking is very high. You should have asked 80 rupees or 90 rupees or something like that. Then people like me who think, who are in difference of opinion with you, that what your value should be, they will not probably subscribe. So that's why ultimately, you know, the level of oversubscription depends on public perception of the real valuation. And then the market price also depends on the same thing afterwards. And obviously at some point of time, your performance takes over and obviously you will rise to much better levels. But for that intermittent point of time, the pricing will be more of a matter of perception of the individuals who are in the same ecosystem.
Hello, sir.
Yeah, sir. Okay, go ahead. Yes.
So my name is Akhilesh from BIIB Finance. So my question is general. It's a situation based. If I am an entrepreneur down the line 20 years, and I am facing a disruption from my competitor. He made a disruption in the market. As a fellow competitor, I will be in trouble. So at a situation like this, what I should do? Should I merge with other company or should I upgrade a technology which is compatible to my competitors?
No, there are, in business we say fight or flight. Okay, the choice is individual's choice, right? There are no perfect solutions there, right? If you have the guts, you fight it out. You become even more disruptive. If you think it's not going to work, you don't have it in you, you have to, you know, choose the other option, right? So what you should do is what you should decide. I don't think, you know, somebody else will come and give you a prescription.
Also, sir, is that even if after 20 years some disruption happens, so what? It's a general question that what all the competitors in that area, that sector itself, would do at such a, in this situation where Nokia was facing, said Nokia did do anything to survive further or upgrade technology. So at that, after 20 years, what disruptions may happen, and if that happen, what other competitors should do? That one question.
So, Tane, I'll just attempt to answer your point. There is no right or there is no not so right answer to it. It is purely situational. What Nokia did was they thought it's best to sell out, and that's what they did. They divested and they sold out. Whether they would have merged with somebody, whether they would have partnered with somebody and brought about a larger disruption, is, I'm sure the promoters would have thought about it, but the option they thought was best was to sell out. Similarly, the way you see in telecom operators, Airtel has decided to fight out what's going on. Vodafone and Idea decided to merge and bring about larger disruption because they would have 40+ market share when they merge. A lot of other operators have either sold their assets or they're on their way out. So it depends who has what value perception, who wants to do what, and who wants to be where in that space. So it's pretty situational, no right or not so right answer. But yes, and also you have to, as an entrepreneur, if you have thought, if you see that disruption has not suddenly happened after 20 years, It happens on a daily basis. And as an entrepreneur, he has to be on his toes more than anybody else to see what are the trends and what we should do in as much in anticipation as possible.
That's a big point there. You know, forget about Nokia. The one which really disrupted earlier was Micromax, right? Did a great job for a few years, right? And then, you know, we all see what has happened over the last 5 years itself, right? So they were disruptive, but events overtook whatever. So there is the answer there. Okay.
Good afternoon, sir. So my question is, whenever there is a disruption in the market, what I see is there is more of a destruction along with it, which comes in its way. Like, just to give you examples, when Jio came into the market, there was a destruction for the competitive industry. When like AI and IoT is coming into the market, there is a destruction in losing of the jobs in IT industry. And even in technology field, after 2 or 3 months, most of the technology gets obsolete and new technology comes into its place. So what is your take into it? Like, how do the businessmen see to it, and how do they, because huge amount of investments is getting in a way whenever there is such things happen in the market. So what is your take on it, sir?
You know, one thing, the basic premises of living life is growth. Every day you have to, when you go to office or do anything in life, just think, how am I growing? How can I grow bigger tomorrow? How can I grow stronger tomorrow? Change is a way of life. If you have studied little anything about Origin of Species by Charles Darwin, species also get extinct. There is no sympathy in this world. If you are good enough, you survive. If you are not good enough, you go. Simple. The point for you is that be good enough at all points of time. Be ruthless. Don't worry about what can happen to me. Fear of failure is very defeating. Don't worry about failures. Worry about how you are going to overcome your position. And just think how you are going to strengthen your position. If you think about positive, how you are going to become more stronger, probably you will figure out ways and you will think ahead of the competition. If you think ahead of the competition, obviously, you know, your competition worries about survival.
So only suggestion to most of you guys asking these questions is, there's a very, very old book by Andy Grove. Andy Grove is who? Nobody knows. Nobody knows? Andy Grove, who said that? Founder of Intel. You know, we talk about a lot of companies today. Intel is a company which was profitable for 25 straight years. They grew their profits. That's the name of the book, right? Which is what they had to do to keep ahead in the industry. They kept pushing their own products out. They kept innovating, kept pushing, so that nobody else could enter that space. That's a very good book, very thin book, very easy read, by Andy Grove, called Only the Vanguard Survive.
So my question is, do you think there is a need of a disruption in the share market, particularly in the broking business? And if so, what will it be? And will it be beneficial for the investors?
See, disruption is a way of life for any businesses. Every day we do something, something new comes up. Today, you know, we are talking of, a national market. BSE has already started an international exchange in Gandhinagar, GIFT City. At some point of time, we'll be competing with global financial hubs such as Singapore, London, Hong Kong. See, one thing is we tend to get a bit jittery when we talk of disruption. Disruption is nothing but innovation by someone, which is affecting us. So if somebody has done something good, obviously you need to figure out what you are going to do. Now just take an example of Serum Institute, where Mr. Apurva said that, they are going to come out with a vaccine which is going to change the way how you actually, inject a vaccination. Now, the thing is like this, that this is going to hit a lot of other vaccination companies also who are making this thing. They will also have to sit and figure out. And it's not that they will have to come out with a different solution. Probably in 1 or 2 years' time, they will also get the same type of patch. And they will also survive. So, as far as the finance markets comes today, you see banks are more in threat. Because in China, the payment banks, intermediaries, the small payment intermediaries, have actually overtaken bank function. And they are now becoming larger than many banks. So the point is like this, that means for us also, means we go into bigger, larger competition, that creates disruption in the way we do everything. Because when we compete with others, we have to figure out what are his strategies. And we have to ensure that we have a counter for that strategy. And it may be totally different from what we are doing now.
With disruption comes the opportunity for eruption, like closing of one door and innovative opening of another door. As what Amitabh sir said, for the Serum, we have another opportunity, another chance for taking it by ourselves, and but losing of another job by compounders. So how is it affecting our economy, sir?
Well, I think one overall thing is, I was in a sort of big thing addressed by Prime Minister Modi called Startup India. And I mean, I'm saying from the Uber person to Ola person, everybody was in the room. And there was a person who founded Oyo Rooms, right? And I think of the entire lot of people on the dais with Prime Minister Modi, this boy who's, you know, school, college dropout, whatever, he's 25, 26 year old. Forget about his business model or whatever. The clarity of thought he had in terms of what he wants to do, how he wants to build further, I think he overshadowed everybody else, except the PM himself. Of course, he speaks in a different, so it's a different thing. But he was the one who was a star speaker. Ritesh, whatever, he's hardly 25, 26 year old. Yeah. And equally stunning was, the hall was 10 times its size and packed. Many people are standing outside. So probably there are 2,000 seats, probably 4,000 people were there wanting to build a business. Right? And these are the people who got invites, etc., etc. There will be more millions waiting out somewhere. Right? So that is what has changed, and that is what will change further. Right? More and more people wanting to do different things, things differently, creating some things on their own, right? Yeah.
Just to add on what has been said here is that today there are a lot of industries and a lot of enterprises which were not there yesterday. And there would be a lot tomorrow which are there today, and a lot new will happen tomorrow. So this is how it will be. What is important is, as we move on from part A to part B to part C in moments of time, the rate of industrialization used to be what, 30, 35 years till about year 2000. I think the rate of industrialization is now in terms of years, and maybe it will be months going forward. So that is how it is happening. So one opportunity is out, another is in, and with that in, there is a lot more than be done, and that is how the evolution will happen. Maybe there are a lot of management lessons and the studies which will tell you that overall job creation has not diminished in any of the revolution which has happened till now, and it has always helped the mankind to keep changing. If you are a steady state, you will be still. That's the bottom line.
Sir, you bounced off a beautiful idea that a disruption is not only about changing, rather bundling up with the services and providing this. So for better understanding of ours and our, my fellow mates, so could you share with us what the product was about that you were dealing with, and what services did you bundle it with, and how it helped your company?
Okay, so the product that we were talking about, I worked for a agri chem company, you know, and we had two divisions. We had a division which used to make seeds. So all the vegetable and pulses that you eat are all by Syngenta. Okay, it's a Swiss company. And we had a division which was a chemical division wherein we sold pesticides. Okay, so fungicides, herbicides and weedicides. Now these two divisions work separately. And we decided, and each one of them, the sales guy will go and sell the seed, and then the second division will go and sell the pesticides. Okay? we decided to merge these. Okay, we decided to merge it and we said we are selling a solution for you. So we used to go to the customer and we say that this is what you need to use before you sow the seeds. Here are the seeds. Here are the different chemicals once you have sown the seeds for different stages. And once you have done that at the harvesting time, this is what you need to do. So we were selling the entire solution in one go, you know. So that's what we did, which no other company still is doing. They're still going separately and selling the same product. That means that the sales guy has to go to the same customer twice or thrice or four times. Okay, so that was the product.
I'll give you basically one more example from my career, okay, which is not about the solution or product. It's about how you look at creating a business. So I launched a pet food called Pedigree in India. And at that point in time, I mean, 2003, nobody would think of buying dog food. People would feed the table scraps and so on and so forth. So globally, the pet food business is a huge business. And the company I used to work for, Mars, has a $15 billion highly profitable pet food business. And so the challenge was, a country like China has 100 million dogs. Mexico City has 40 million dogs. But in India, we have 4 million dogs. Nobody used to care about what they feed their dog. Pet ownership was not a big thing. And so how do you go and advertise? What do you tell people? They're feeding zero. They're currently giving, at that point in time, whatever they were eating, part of that to the dog. So to go and say, please buy Pedigree worth 150 rupees a kilo, you'll take 1,000 rupees a month to feed your dog. Nobody is going to do that. Okay? So all marketing, any brilliant advertising may or may not have worked. So what did we do? We identified that the veterinary doctors in the country are the biggest influencers. It's a simple thing. And we also realized that most veterinary doctors at that point in time all veterinary doctors even today in their 5-year BBSC course. And are there any veterinarians here? Anybody? No? So in a BBSC course of 5 years, most veterinary doctors study for 4 hours about small animals, which is dogs and cats. Rest is all about cattle and poultry. So we spent all our money. We flew out 400 veterinary doctors from India to a center in UK which Mars owns to show them what it means. And we spent the first 3 years just training veterinary doctors in India on how to deal with small animals. And that was not required, nobody told us and so on. But that's what we did. And in turn, these veterinary doctors helped us to tell their customers who are dog owners and get them to start feeding Pedigree. That's all we did first 3 years. No advertising, no nothing. So that was a bit of a disruption we did, and Mars had not done that globally anywhere in the world. No one had told us this. No one knew what is how to sell pet food. So that's what we did, and that helped us create this market. Okay.
Good afternoon, sir. So my question is to Nayan, sir. As we are talking about AI every time. So, can you tell us that how AI will impact the equity research analyst in future? Is it like that AI will replace equity the jobs of equity research analyst?
No, AI, frankly, it's a difficult question. One thing is sure, AI is going to affect everyone going forward. It is going to become a threat also at some point of time to mankind and probably long term. The point is like this, that today a lot of algos are still being used in trading, and this is based on the order flow which happens in the market. So suppose there is something called as order book. So how many people want to buy a stock, how many people want to sell a stock? Now this order book is generally available to clients and to brokers. What happens is that based on the order flow, today many of the brokers are able to set up software which will be able to continuously calibrate their own buys and sell orders and, you know, take their positions. And this thing also happens in across the globe, where, you know, they have got this type of facilities. And obviously the thing is that things do get sophisticated over a period of time. People have to learn, people have to get used to it. And basically it will basically help you in, you know, a much more efficient market, much more liquidity into the market.
Into equity research analysts.
It's like this, you know, that see, nobody can replace humans as on date. And so the point is that ultimately whatever aggregation AI does, AI will basically do an aggregation job in this case. Whatever information comes with respect to a company called, let's say, Infosys, that gets aggregated from XYZ sources, known sources, unknown sources, how many times you have clicked Infosys in Google, how many times we have dialed Infosys number, phone number, or whatever, how many times anybody has spoken Infosys on web. All that thing will get aggregated and probably it will result into some sort of sensitivity leading to some predictability as to there's something going on in Infosys. And obviously, ultimately, it will be human judgment to figure out as to what is this actual action going to be.
Okay.
Thank you, sir.
Thanks.
Hey, good afternoon to all of you. So my question is related to the telecom sector. Myself, Saurabh Das from Marketing BIIB. So my question is that the telecom sector today stands at a debt of rupees 5 lakh crore. And the banks have stopped lending money to the telecom companies. And with the entrant of Jio, the tariffs have reduced to more than 90%. So my question is, how does the telecom sector plan to get rid of this debt?
So yes, rightly said, maybe the numbers are slightly here and there, but yes, the debt of telecom is more than twice the revenue at this point of time. And the sector is under stress because the tariff tables are getting lower by the day. However, on the technology side, the rate of obsolescence. You remember when 2G was installed in 90s, it still is on, while 3G, which was installed in 2007, 8 or 10, is almost out and 4G is in. So the rate of change of technology, that means the investment also needs a lot. So these are the points which are going to be there. You can't say no to this. What is important is how do we change business model? How do we prioritize in terms of how do we change the shape of the user? So the user earlier was very voice user. Now the user is very data user. Now within data, there are millions of opportunities to monetize. There are millions of upsell and downsell possibilities. So all the operators are trying to scratch the bottom as of today. But I would not be surprised if the sector as such will harden the tariffs at some point, because the users are demanding more, better quality, and it will have some impact on the prices that you see. But the size is so large enough, the volume is so high, that some changes here and there would always be very, very productive, and it will help operators, users, the government, everybody to come out of this situation. So I do feel that you will see some hardening of sector in terms of the usage and in terms of the tariffs.
Yeah, I also believe consolidation will happen, efficiencies will kick in the sector. So that's going to happen, but I would request now, we have probably 10 minutes left. Only questions on the subject, please. Rest, industry, whether it's on shares, on other things, specific questions, please keep it after the session.
Hi, sir. A very good afternoon to you.
Two questions, please.
First of all, this was a very inspiring session because leadership itself are very motivational kind of thing. So we are a little motivated right now. So my question is to you, sir, what should be the modus operandi for new entrants like us, because we are going to work in industry in very upcoming years right now. So what should be our working style or modus operandi for new students, freshers in the industry? So it should be lateral or should be traditional?
got your point. So I was actually thinking in those lines 2 minutes back.
Yes.
So I'll spend maybe 3-4 minutes with your permission, how to link this topic to leadership and then how we can link it to young generation. We have heard and known about disruption now, disruptive businesses, disruptive industry. This essentially needs disruptive leaders. Disruptive leadership is required to create disruption. Possibly, that may not be done by probably some of our elders. So it is all for you, young generation, to become more and more disruptive leaders. So how to become a disruptive leader? I don't know. I have no answer for that. Not sure how to become a disruptive leader. But there are some basic fundamentals, probably, which might help you in your journey, in your career. Lot of things are required, but some of the basic things, in a layman's language, if I make you understand, is 4 basic things. Is honesty. All of you understand what is honesty?
Yes, sir.
Maybe helpfulness is the second right. Hardworking is the third one. Humble is the fourth one. So these 4 fundamental core values are essential to any leader, including a disruptive leader. Though some of the disruptive leaders are little maverick in the initial days of their career, eventually these 4 characters that they had really helped them to create repeated disruptions and also sustain it.
So, just to add, okay, I think I just, fundamentally, when you are hired by an organization, okay, you must first, of course, choose a type of organization which is, you know, where you are interested, right? I find if you are an agreed graduate, join a bank, kind of work you do is different, right? So if you are good enough, if you are lucky enough, you get into a setup organization where your interests lie, right? Understand what is expected from your role, from whoever is your boss, okay? Today, for most organizations, the front line or people at, you know, whatever level, the first level, second level, are critical, okay? It is not sort of just a saying, but we do run organizations bottoms up in most cases. So, like I said right at the beginning, you must understand your own importance first. So, in addition to what he said, I think if you understand why you are in an organization, what role are you playing, okay? And therefore, what is it that you bring to the table? Okay? So, if you are saying whether I should be lateral, whether I should do this, the answer lies in doing, understanding what you're supposed to do, and finding creative, better solutions to what you inherit. Okay? 99% of the people I've interviewed in my life, which would be more than 2,500 plus, say, when I took over this job, boss, the earlier thing was a mess. If I go by that, then I think everybody was in mess all along, right? So that's what everybody says, but do you actually do it, right? So that's the thing you have to ask, and that will give you the answer, okay? So every place, every organization, right, can do with improvement, can do with changes. Question is, can you contribute? Okay? If you can, please do. Anybody will be happy.
Thank you, sir.
Just to add on this, one is that, you know, you also have to learn the skills which will help you to survive in this disruptive world. You know, because the skills like technology adoption, right, learning agility, change ready. So these are some of the skills that one has to develop in order to survive in this disruptive world. because eventually it's going to impact you as well, as an employee, as a member of that organization, right? So you have to also figure out that how do you survive and how do you continue to grow and contribute within the organization.
Thank you, panel members, for sharing your views on disruptive leadership and giving us real-life examples from the industry like Kodak, IBM, Flipkart, Apple, Uber, and also telling us that the disruptions are successful if the idea is unique. The various roles a leader should play to lead a disruption who empowers the organization. We also got a view upon how changes are driven by customers and disruptions by innovators. The panel also threw light upon how rapid changes are happening in economy and how these innovations will have an unknown repercussion in the society. The panel also discussed on how everyone should be the part of change and accept it willfully and should have a visionary approach toward it. Thank you once again for enlightening us with your words of wisdom. Thank you.